जत अखिल निज त्रीं मैत्रीं भजत अखिल निज त्रीं आत्मवदेव परानपि पश्यत आत्मवदेव परानपि पश्यत युद्धं त्यजत स्पर्धां त्यजत युद्धं त्यजत स्पर्धां त्यजत त्यजत परेश्व अक्रममाक्रमणं त्यजत परेश्व क्रममाक्रमणं जननी पृथ्वी कामदुगास्ते जननी पृथ्वी कामदुगास्ते जनको देवः सकलदयालु जनको देवः सकलदयालु दाम्यतदात दयत्वां जनता दात दयत्वां जनता श्रेयो भूयात् सकल जनानां श्रेयो भूयात् श्रेयो भूयात् सकल जनानां श्रेयो भूयात् सकल जनानां श्रेयो भूयात् सकल जनानां श्रेयो भूयात् सकल जनानां।
हाय सुधा, हाय राजी, गीता, हाउ लवली टू सी ऑल ऑफ यू। हाउ हैव यू बीन?
Very busy, ladies. My daughter's wedding is coming up, no?
Oh, is that so? When is it?
Next month.
Oh, I love our wedding. So much color, so much happening.
Absolutely. But I am having such a hard time arguing with Varsha about everything. She's questioning everything, starting from why should we get up so early in the morning?
Oh, that's easy. Brahma Muhurtam is the creator's hour. It's the time when there is an abundance of oxygen, peace, quiet, a certain conducive atmosphere when there is natural production of melatonin, which is a mood stabilizer. It boosts your immunity, increases your energy levels, and enhances the reproductive system. Your nervous system is also in a state of natural equilibrium, which reduces your stress levels and makes you calm. The benefits of rising early are corroborated by evidences in Ayurveda, which acknowledges it to be the time when sattva manifests itself, eradicating rajas and tamas. It's time to recreate yourself. Basically, wake up at Brahma Muhurtam and create your me time. And remember that most top achievers in the world start their days really early. Not without reason, as it said, Dhamme Muhurtam Uttishte Tvasto Rakshartham Ayushan.
And there are a number of small things that we can do after getting up before dawn, which makes a big difference, you know. For example, the sages have mentioned that after waking up and sitting up for a few minutes of prayer, we should touch Mother Earth with our palms, apologizing for the pressure we are going to put on her. The energy within the body while sleeping is static energy or a potential energy. As we get up, it becomes kinetic or a dynamic energy. As we touch Mother Earth, the static energy, which is impure, leaves the body and the pure energy fills in. And remaining humble to the place we live in also gives us a mental balance, right?
So wow, even I didn't know all this. I will tell Varsha all this and maybe get her to talk to you too. Meanwhile, I have another problem. Her favorite aunt is traveling from New York and she is refusing to travel on Ashtami and Navami. And Varsha is making a big fuss about that also.
Raji, what is the reason behind that? Even I would like to know that.
It has to do with the phases of the moon, Geeta. See, the moon has a typical cycle starting from Amavasya, one Amavasya to the next. Now, if this cycle, every day the moon moves 12 degrees. And so each day is called as a Tithi. And that's why we have Pradamai, Dvitiyai. And as all of you know, the 8th and 9th day are called as Ashtami and Navami. In this cycle, whether it is Sukla Paksham from Amavasya to Purnami or Krishna Paksham from Purnami to Amavasya, the 8th and 9th days, the moon is farthest from the earth and they are not very bright days. And the gravitational pull also is the least on these days. So it was considered that these days were not very auspicious. And people were encouraged to spend these days in bhakti. That is why he used to say, right, Ashtami Aniki Krishna Ranenshiko, Navami Aniki Rama Ranenshiko. We have Gokula Ashtami and Rama Navami also. And people started tracking the calendar. And when they saw the moon grow, it was considered auspicious. And when they saw it wane, it was considered inauspicious. All this has its basis in Jyotisha Shastra, which is one of the Veda Angas. And psychologically, since everyone cannot be positive at all times, when auspicious days were nearing, people were forced to think and work towards that date. And to create a balance in faith, some days were considered as inauspicious.
Oh, there's so much to all these things. You know, I was just thinking of the wedding, and for me personally, the ritual I like best at all these weddings is when the priest asks the young couple to come out and look at the sky and look at Vashishta and Arundhati. And the kids are always laughing because, you know, looking at the sky at broad daylight and trying to look for stars. But the fundamental reasoning behind that is so beautiful. Vashishta is part of the Saptarishi or the Western Ursa Major constellation. Vashishta and Arundhati are twin stars which revolve around each other. Neither is static, neither is dominant. So they complement each other. The priest, therefore, is actually telling the young couple to be like Arundhati and Vashishta, who were considered the ideal couple, to be on an equal footing, neither dominating and neither being the follower.
So beautiful, and just the kind of thoughts that would resonate with my daughter. I really, really wish she listened to all this.
I know. I love this conversation, you know. I think we should get together our children and grandchildren and talk to them about these things and a lot of other similar things. In ancient times, our sages had the knowledge and the wisdom to formulate our habits and practices.
Unfortunately, the logic behind these has been lost over time. And subsequent generations have just been adopting the practices without the reason.
I'm happy that some generations are questioning this, though it seems to be a token rituals.
I know, but this just might open the doors to a better understanding and an acceptance of a very healthy and scientific way of life. Don't you think so?
Yeah, I'm sure it will, Sushi. But ladies, you have to excuse me. I have so much work. Hoping to see all of you at the wedding next month.
Raji, let us know if we can rest anyway.
Definitely. And anyway, I will see you in Sanskrit class on Monday. Bye. All of you have a wonderful day.
Bye. Namaste, Ratish.
Namaste.
How are you?
Long time no see. Where were you?
Very busy, Ratish. Very busy. I have got grandchildren. They're keeping me busy. And with the lockdown now, all the families around, and then you have to manage this, that, and the other. It is a wonderful time at the same time. Very, very busy. Very busy. But, Ratish, you know, when I see my grandchildren, when we're all eating together, I get very concerned.
It is something natural because we don't eat the way they do. We never ate the way they do. And we were healthier. If you see the children, we were much healthier than how they are now. But of course,
definitely,
we never had
so. Yes, Ratish. Look how young you also look. I mean, you are also a grandfather now. But you know, I think there's something with to do with our eating habits. I think we need to convey that to our grandchildren.
I am shifting to my grandchildren's diets now. They don't allow me to do anything else. But
fantastic. Very nice, very nice. So I can only give them a certain knowledge about food because you know it, Ratish. I had done only my in our BSc when we went to college together. I only graduated from my nutrition science. But after that, you went off and you went into Ayurveda and you're a doctor today. So I was thinking that I should definitely seek your help in this because it is very important for me to convey to my grandchildren.
No, whatever little I know, I will be happy to share. Ayurveda is for everybody. It is not for anybody.
You're very, very thankful for that. So coming back to it, the maximum I can tell is, Papa, you can have this at a certain time of the day. And then you can have fresh food, home-cooked food, hot food. And when you sit down to eat, it should not have any stress. Phone, you should not see. TV, you should not see. You should sit in love. And then, you know, you have to respect your food. This is what I tell Ratish.
You are speaking pure Ayurveda now. You know, you are speaking pure Ayurveda. Charaka mentioned the same things. And you have reached there without any studying Ayurveda. That is fabulous.
You know how they look up to grandmothers for more information and more knowledge. So I don't want to appear ignorant. That is why I'm making this call to you.
That is okay. Tell me, what do you want to know? I'll tell you whatever I know.
I want to explain to them about how guna and what you eat can influence them.
That is very important because the gunas, there are plenty of gunas, I know 20 types of gunas in Ayurveda, but basically what you are going to tell them is about the sattvic, rajasic, that mano gunas, right? And mano doshas.
Yes, that is enough to make the children understand.
So simply tell them whatever brings some positive feelings in them, that is sattvic. Whatever stimulates them to do certain things, strong things, anger and such things, those will be rajasic. Whatever delays them, whatever keeps them stagnant or stationary, that will be tamasic. Tamasa means dark, tamas. So in the dark, you are not able to move forward. That means it is stopping you. Rajasika is, you know, you take very spicy food, you get all stimulated to fight and all those things. Sattvika is something that you take prasads and all, you are very peaceful. So this is the simplest way to tell them that sattvika will always be good for you. It will be easy on the stomach, it won't stimulate you, it won't harm you, it won't cause any ulcers. You know, ulcer is caused by hurry, worry, curry. Okay, so that is it. So just simply tell them whatever they like. And whatever brings them the positive side inside them, they feel comfortable, that is your sattvic food. And, you know, whatever is stimulant, that is rajasic. And whatever, you know, after taking a food, you feel sleepy, drowsy and all those things and causes problems in the body, that is tamasic food. Simple.
Oh, you really simplified it for me, Ratish. Because I remember my grandmother, when I was a 10-year-old, this she would always say, Subbu, you should have only food that is good for you, and it is sattvic food. You know, when she would tell me that, I will not really understand, but somewhere it registered in my mind. So this is what I want to convey to my grandchildren.
That answer, the glow in your face is because of that food only. Your food.
Sure, you make me feel so shy.
So I can't see you blushing now.
I will definitely call you up for any other information. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. Namaste.
Aham Vaishvanaro Bhutva Praninam Deham Ashritaha Pranapana Samayuktaha Pachamyanyam Chaturvidham
Vasva Tatsavitu Vareiniyam.
Renu has gone through a lot of problems related to her business and finances during this uncertain and tough time of COVID. She has been a leader par excellence. She has always been motivating and positive in her approach. She looks upset and dull today. What happened, Renu? Why are you looking so upset? Why are you depressed? I have never seen you like this.
You know what's happening in the global scenario. It has affected me with a lot of financial problems, health issues at home. A lot of known people are affected. I just don't know what to do. I'm completely low down and depressed.
So if you're going to be depressed, Renu, and down, what will happen to your business? What will happen to the people who are working for you? What will happen to your near and dear ones? People are not well at home and they look forward to you. And if you are going to be upset, what's going to be their plight? You have always been a leader and you have always been an influencer where people have followed you. People around you look up to you, Renu. This reminds me of this particular shloka of Bhagavad Gita.
Yadyad acharati shrestha tattadevotaro janah sayat pramanam kurute lokastadanuvartate.
These are the words said by Shri Krishna to Arjun, and see how it's relevant today. So this is the solution for our situation today. An extremely important but subtle point made by Krishna is hidden in the phrase, ideal person does. Shreshta acharati yata yata. You are a leader and you should lead by example. Therefore, yesterday is equal to tomorrow. If we can link to this, during these current times, during this COVID uncertain times, we are supposed to have social distancing, wear our masks, stay indoors, use our time efficiently instead of cribbing about the situation. So it's all about leading by example. So now, Renu, you have understood the leadership lesson, how to lead by example. What would you like to add?
Uddharedatmaratmaram natmaramavasadayet atmaivahatmano banduhu atmaivaripuratmanaham bandhuratmatmanastasya enatmaivatmanajidaha anatmanastu shatrutve vartetatmaivashatruvat.
One should lift oneself by one's own efforts and should not degrade oneself. For one's own self is one's friend and one's own self is one enemy. You are your own friend when you use your personality towards your own progress, and you become your own foe when you use the very same equipment to go downhill.
Emotional strength is very important today, and leaders have to be very strong and they have to have complete control over their emotions. We cannot be attached to the results. Get up and act. Have the courage to come out of the darkness. Don't be in delusion. Therefore, yesterday is equal to tomorrow. In today's time, when so many people are getting affected, getting emotional is not going to solve the problem. Rather, it may complicate it. So we have to have complete control over our emotions to help ourselves and others.
Yatra Yogeshwarah Krishnah, Yatra Partho Dhanurdharah, Tatra Sri Vijayo Bhutihi, Dhruvani Tirma Tirmama.
Where there is human effort, irrespective of the situation, we have to do our role without attachment. And when our human effort is there, God will be supporting us. So when divinity and human effort get together, then we will be prosperous and successful.
Gita, the song of God, is part of the epic Mahabharata, which is the story of a great war fought between two sets of cousins, one set noble and the other crooked. On another level, it is a battle that rages in our minds and hearts each day. Each day, we are confused about what the right thing to do is. And we wish we could run away from the battle rather than face its consequences. But Krishna, who lives in all of us, the small, still voice of our conscience, tells us clearly and loudly what we ought to be doing. Gita is Krishna's dictate, gentle but no nonsense dictate, to his confused and nervous friend Arjuna, and through him to all of us.
Dhanyavaad.
नमस्कारम् साहित्य संगीत कलाविहीन साक्षात् पशु पृच्छ विषाणहीन दिस सुभाषितम् इन संस्कृत कन्वेज आवर सिविलाइजेशंस व्यू दैट विदाउट आवर आर्ट्स म्यूजिक एंड स्टोरीज वी आर जस्ट एनिमल्स विदाउट टेल एंड हॉर्न्स ओल्डर ए सिविलाइजेशन एनॉर्मस आर इट्स रिजर्वॉयर ऑफ स्टोरीज आवर स्टोरीज सर्व द पर्पस ऑफ प्रोटेक्टिंग आवर कल्चर नॉलेज एंड बिलीव्स व्हेन मेनी ऑफ द इन्वेडर्स ट्राइड देयर बेस्ट टू डिस्ट्रॉय without a trace. Our stories subtly hit philosophy and sciences that were passed through them to future generations, and it just needs to be uncovered. Asha ji, a professional storyteller herself, gives her take on stories. Asha ji?
Shiva, can't you entertain me with a story? Demanded Parvati. Shiva obliged. You see, even gods cannot escape the fundamental duty of the husband pleasing the wife. So goes the tale in the first ever known ancient text of stories called the Brihat Katha or the Great Tale by Gunadhyay. Unfortunately, much of it has been lost today. But luckily, we have the Katha Sarit Sagara or the Ocean of Stream of Stories by Somadeva. It is a voluminous text with many stories. If only we take the time to look into our ancient texts, we will find many stories.
Thank you, Ashaji. Your craft was very visible from that. Anuji, could you please tell us how stories were passed on through different techniques in India?
Stories are a way of looking at life. They are an important part of our culture. If you look at our music or dance, in fact, many of them do have either direct narration of stories or suggestions of a story in context to our epics. Today, I am going to mention some of the styles of storytelling in India. Kathakali got evolved as a full dance theatre to tell the stories of Ramayana and Mahabharata. Kalamkari is an art form that depicts stories from our itihasa on textiles. Pandavani is a style which uses songs to tell the stories of the Pandavas. For us, stories of our ancestors are not just something that belongs to the past, but they surround us wherever we go.
Thank you, Anuji. That was informative. In a vast country like India, surely more ways exist. Sumaji, could you tell us a few more techniques?
The earliest form of storytelling exists in visual stories drawn on cave walls to the painting of Puranic stories on temple walls. Over time, visual stories became audiovisual. In Rajasthan, there's a tradition still. Stories are painted on wooden boxes and storytellers carry this kavad as tools to relate stories. Tolu Bommalata in Andhra Pradesh and southern India refer to storytelling through puppetry, where movement is depicted along with story. Villupattu is another indigenous form of storytelling in Tamil Nadu, combining the use of a musical instrument, song and dialogue. Kootu exists as Yakshagana in Karnataka. Kodiyattam still remains almost the only form of surviving Sanskritam drama in Kerala. Kadakalakshebam and Harikatha use music sometimes dance and mime to extol the scriptures with more drama, humor and philosophy. I have touched only a few of the myriad storytelling forms of our country.
Thank you, Sumaji. That's a lot in a nutshell. Most of our stories were in poetic form. Reggie, being a poet yourself, could you tell us something interesting in some ancient poetic stories?
Let me tell you about Meghaduta, an ancient Sanskrit lyrical poem by Kalidasa. It tells the story of a Yaksha who lives in exile on earth away from his beloved wife. In solitude and pain, he finds a cloud to send a message to her. In verse 35, Yaksha is paying a religious oblation to the cloud with Kudaja flowers and prays for the successful delivery of his message. The interesting point here is that Kudaja is mentioned in Charaka Samhita as an action-based drug to treat diarrhea. Yaksha is hoping that Kudaja will help the cloud in retaining his message by preventing any disassociation of the cloud until it reaches his wife. So it is obvious here that Kalidasa was aware of the medicinal properties of Kudaja and he is subtly mentioning it. So, be it a poem or a story, ancient authors are undoubtedly messengers of our great culture, rooted in deep scientific wisdom.
That's amazing. We definitely should revisit our old stories again. Thank you all.
Namaste, Lakshmi. Do you remember we went to Kalakshetra for a dance drama?
Namaste. Of course. Before the play, the speaker quoted Bharatamuni. Natat jnanam, natat shilpam, nasa vidya, nasa kala, naso yogo natat karmam, nachesmin yenna drishyate, which means there is no knowledge, craft, art, yoga or action that is not within the ambit of performing arts.
Yes, true. Natya Shastra is a magnum opus. The syllables Bharatha stand for Bhava, Raga and Tala. Dr. Balamurli Krishna interprets it as Bhakti, Rakti and Tanmayatvam, that is devotion, emotion and aesthetic sense.
Is it so? It is also known as the fifth Veda, since Lord Brahma drew literature from Rig Veda, music from Samaveda, expressions from Yajurveda, and aesthetics from Atharva Veda.
Whatever is its origin, it's certainly the oldest available Sanskrit treatise on dramaturgy, which has had its influence from Afghanistan to Indonesia.
You know, Natya Shastra has also impacted areas like psychology, architecture, vocal and instrumental music, costume and makeup, and even yoga.
Natya Shastra is a seamless blend of Nritta, Nritya and Natya, elaborating on several hand gestures which stimulate activities of the brain. Similarly, the body stances translate to some of the yogic postures noted in the Yoga Sutra of Patanjali. The 108 Natyakarnas give us static elements to offset the dynamic movement of the dance. Performers require agility, strength and stamina. All these inner qualities can be developed and maintained by practicing yoga.
Bharatamuni has not only elaborated the structure of a play, but also the structure in which the play is performed. From site selection, earth preparation, measurements of spaces, the stage, audience, green room, interior decoration, and even seating arrangements. The playhouse is of three types: square, rectangular, triangular, and also small, medium, and large in size. There are many interesting features. When the foundation is laid, musical instruments are to be sounded and payasam is to be served. There's a front door for audiences, a rear entry for performers, and privacy between the stage and the green room. There's a wooden railing prescribed at the stage edge to protect actors from intoxicated persons in the audience. Today, we have theaters with air conditioning, sound systems, etc. But the core design follows principles of Natya Shastra, especially in traditional theaters like at Kalamandalam.
Shall I share another feature? The Natya Shastra is based on an expansive understanding of human psychology. Bharata classifies human emotions into eight, called the Ashtarasa. To put it simply, the emotions that are expressed by the performer are the bhavas, and that which is experienced by the audience is the rasa. Bharata Muni lists the process of each emotion, subjective experience, psychological response, and behavioral response of every character in various situations. Each of these ashtarasas are associated with a specific color, a swaram or a musical note, and a deity. Shantarasa was added later on as the ninth rasa to make it the Navarasa today. Speaking of colors, I should talk about the costume and makeup. Bharata Muni classifies characters to be dressed according to their nature and the predominant mode in the play, with appropriate choice of color, design, and ornamentation.
Apart from these subjects, Natya Shastra also covers music extensively. Natya Shastra provides the musical notes and scales to use for both vocal and instrumental music, and addresses the usage of music with drama. Musical instruments are classified as string instruments, percussion instruments, wind instruments, and cymbals. And Natya Shastra provides the guidelines for making these instruments also. What is most amazing is the timeline of when this was all done. If you look at the timeline of performing arts, most of what we consume today via television, movies, internet, etc., was created in the last few hundred years, including the Carnatic music by the Trinity, Western classical music by Bach, Beethoven, Mozart, etc. The popular opinion states that Natya Shastra was written between 500 BCE and 500 CE, which puts it a couple of thousand years back. Experts such as Dr. Padma Subramaniam believe that Bharata Muni was a peer of Valmiki, which would put Natya Shastra on the same timeline as Ramayana, making it even more ancient.
Bharata actually provides intellectual freedom for continuity and change. Natya Shastra allows flexibility and adaptation of rules according to the needs of Kala and Desha, both time and place. What is profound is the very purpose of drama as a vehicle for the spectator to realize his own consciousness and awaken innate spiritual values. We felt this at the performance at Kalakshetra, right? Whether it was centuries ago or today, drama and all performing arts transport you to a totally different, elevated plane.
Exploring Natya Shastra was amazing.
Namaste.
Namaskaram. The universe of ours is throbbing with life in myriad forms, and where there is prana, there is dhvani. The pranavanadam, or the primordial sound, is fundamental to Vedic chanting. From birth to death, there are as many as 16 different samskaras where Veda mantras are chanted. Are these just rituals that have lost their relevance? I do not understand the meaning of mantras. So are they still beneficial to me? Mananath trayate iti mantraha. So goes the saying, or that which protects due to repeated utterance. Vedic mantras opens our minds to different levels of awareness, both biological and metaphysical. A chant or mantra is simply a reverberation. The person who chants derives certain beneficial effects from uttering it. My friend Raj will further explain the significance of Sanskritam mantras.
धन्यवाद है कविता. सो व्हाई संस्कृत, व्हाई संस्कृत? बिकॉज संस्कृत स्टैंड्स फॉर संयुक्त कृतम, मीन्स प्यूरिटी एट इट्स बेस्ट फॉर्म. सो द क्वेश्चन इज हाउ कैन अ लैंग्वेज सर्वाइव फॉर 3000 प्लस ईयर्स विदाउट अ लाइब्रेरी, विदाउट पब्लिश्ड बुक्स? That's because of the tradition of Sanskritam, where the knowledge was passed from generation to generation through memorizing and through chanting. So the power of chanting is quite immense. I'll allude to one study. It's done by one Dr. James Hartzell, an American neuroscientist. He did a study, he's also a Sanskrit scholar, and he did a study and where he compared people who chanted with people who didn't chant. And in his clinical studies, he found out that the cortical thickness increased, the size of the gray matter increased, the brain region around the memory area of brain increased. So these are clinical findings, actual findings. So chanting actually improves the memory power. Sanskritam has a power to heal as well as to annihilate. So there is an Atharva Veda mantra that says, Mutra Mochana, and it has a power to heal failing kidneys. And of course, we've read in literature, and especially Mahabharata, where weapons were launched based on a mantra and they had the ability to destroy. So with this kind of a power, there's also a saying in Sanskritam that says, Aksharam Amantram Nasti, which means there is no character, no letter in Sanskritam that cannot be used for a mantra. So, to demonstrate more and elaborate more on this, there is Srimati Kala, who will expand more. Thank you.
Dhanyavadaha Raj Mahodaya. Sanskritam is all about Dhvani. Urjayaha Prakatikaranam, Dhvani Rupena Bhavati, or the physical manifestation of energy is vibration or sound. Our Vedas contain the science of sound. It lays down rules for how and when mantras are to be chanted, its speed, pitch, and intonation. Hence, mantras have the power to raise one's level of consciousness and to relax the mind. The best example would be our Indian classical music with its specific ragas for specific effects. I'd like to demonstrate to you how the arrangement of notes in a raga lends to the desired effect. I'll now like to sing to you Rag Neelambari for a calming effect and Ragam Kadana Kudugalam for a joyful experience.
Sare mama dadani ga ga pa sa sa ni da pa ma ga pa ma ga re sa re ma ga re re ma da ni da ga ga pa sa 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 ni da pa ma ga pa ma ga re sa re re mama dadani ga pa pa sa sa re re mama ga ga re re sa sa ni ni da da pa pa ma ga re.